grace and peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Today we celebrate the seventh Sunday of Pentecost. My name is Rick Dove, and I'm grateful to worship with you, Church, on this day. I'm especially grateful to be here today because the sun is shining, the flowers are in bloom, and the birds are scurrying around with the other animals. So take some time today and enjoy. I'd also like to welcome the Reverend Dr. David Lindsay, who's going to be doing the service today and next week. Let us pause for a moment to be present in this space. Let us in silence reflect on the truth of how we feel in body and spirit in this moment. We can silently take 2 to 3 breaths. God has called us together today in worship. Let us give that call voice with our call to worship. Creator God, you call us to love and serve you.
Body, mind, and spirit.
Through loving your creation and our sisters and brothers,
open our hearts in compassion and receive these petitions.
The peace of the Lord be with you.
And all of you.
Share a sign of peace.
Peace be with you all.
Invite the congregation to sing with us on verse 1, 2, and 3 of O 4,000 Tongues to Sing, and the choir will sing in parts and solo on verse 4. Thank you.
Oh, for 1,000 tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the glories of our God in Him, the triumphs of God's grace. My gracious Savior and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad the honors of your name. Jesus, the name that calms our fears, that bids our sorrows cease, is music in the sinner's ears, is life and health and a peace. Glory to God alone, and praise be ever, ever.
I'd like to invite forward any and all children who are with us here in the sanctuary to come forward for this conversation that we'll have with one another. Please come on up. Good morning. How are you today? Good. I'm glad you're here. Good morning. Oh, that's all right. It's all right. Good morning. Good morning. Good to see you all. So I'm glad you all are here with us today. I'm really glad to be here again to visit with you all and to preach in a little bit. But I just wanted to share something with you all because I don't want to keep you waiting. You may see that in my bag I have Hershey's Kisses. I have a lot of chocolate here. I've tried to bring enough for everybody, but if you want one, don't have to take one, but I wanted to give you one if you wanted. You can go ahead and pass that around. You're okay? You want one? Great. There you go. Would you like one? There you go. Would you like one as well? Absolutely. All right. We'll share the rest at coffee hour after the service, so there'll be plenty of chance for everybody who wants a Hershey's Kiss to get one. But I wanted to bring you a little something today, just as a little gift from me to you, to offer that, partly because our scripture today is going to talk about this, but God is a gift-giving God. That's one of the things they talk about in the Bible all the time, is that God gives gifts to people. What are some of the gifts you think God gives to us?
Could you say that in the microphone?
Life.
Life?
Life is a big one.
Sunshine.
Sunshine, also a big gift. Yeah.
Food.
Food is an excellent gift. You're welcome to say one if you want to, but you don't have to.
It's up to you.
That's okay. That's okay. So life, sunshine, food, even chocolate. There are a lot of gifts that come from God, but it's one of the important things to remember about God. And when we make our needs known to God, what we really need, not just all the things we want, but what we really need, God listens to those, and God hears us in prayers, and God is a gift-giving God and gives us what we need. It doesn't always come in the form we expect. Sometimes it's an unexpected Hershey's Kiss on a Sunday morning. Sometimes God's gifts come in funny forms, but they do come to us in life, in sunshine, in food, and in so many other ways. Jesus taught his disciples that right as he was teaching them what we now call the Lord's Prayer. Oh, more friends. Welcome. Would you like a Hershey's Kiss? Excellent. Now, we want to make sure there's enough for everybody, so please just take one, all right? If there's more left at the end of coffee hour, you can have more. Great. Would you like a Hershey's Kiss? Yeah. There you go. Great. Excellent. You made trifle yesterday. Here, I thought I was fancy bringing Hershey's Kisses. You made English trifle. That's not easy. I watched Gordon Ramsay try to make that once on MasterChef. That's not easy. You got to get those layers just right. It was? It was good? Oh, what a gift. Oh, lemon and strawberry. What a gift. What a gift. Delightful. Well, one of the gifts that Jesus gave his disciples was teaching them how to pray. And he taught them what we now call the Lord's Prayer. So I'll invite you, everyone here in the sanctuary and online, to join with me in prayer at this time as we pray together the words that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you, friends. You can return to your seats. Can the kids eat in the sanctuary? That's not my decision. That's everybody else's decision. Generally, we save them for after the service. Great. You can eat them outside. Oh, nice. Jelly beans. You all have good food here. If you'd like a little chocolate after the service, please be sure to stop by and say hi.
Listen now in the reading of Scripture for the word and wisdom of God. We open our hearts to the word and wisdom of God. And from Psalm 138, I give you thanks, O Lord, with my whole heart. Before the gods I sing your praise. I bow down towards your holy temple and give thanks to your name for your steadfast love and faithfulness. For you have exalted your name and your word above everything. On the day I called, you answered me. You increased my strength of soul. All the kings of earth shall praise you, O Lord, for they have heard the words of your mouth. They shall sing of the ways of the Lord, for great is the glory of the Lord. For though the Lord is high, he regards the lowly, but the haughty he perceives from far away. Though I walk into the midst of trouble, you preserve me against the wrath of my enemies. You stretch out your hand, and your right hand delivers me. The Lord will fulfill his purpose for me. Your steadfast love, O Lord, endures forever. Do not forsake the work of your hands.
Our gospel reading for this morning comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 11, verses 1 through 13. Of the four gospels, Luke is written especially for Gentile audiences. And so where, for example, Matthew really preaches about Jesus as the Jewish Messiah, Luke is really interpreting the story of Jesus for an audience without roots in Judaism, and really trying to help folks understand. And so we hear throughout the Gospel of Luke an emphasis on Jesus as teacher, teaching the people, just as the author of the Gospel of Luke was looking to teach the Gentile community about the traditions and the stories associated with Jesus. In that spirit, let us hear these words from the Gospel of Luke. Jesus was praying in a certain place, and after he had finished, one of his disciples said to him, "Lord, teach us to pray, as John the Baptist taught his disciples." He said to them, "When you pray, say, 'Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread. And forgive us our sins, for we ourselves forgive everyone indebted to us. And do not bring us to the time of trial.' And he said to them, 'Suppose one of you has a friend, and you go to him at midnight and say to him, "Friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread, for a friend of mine has arrived, and I have nothing to set before him." And he answers from within, 'Do not bother me. The door has already been locked, and my children are with me in bed. I cannot get up and give you anything. I tell you, even though he will not get up and give him anything because he is his friend, at least because of his persistence, he will get up and get him whatever he wants and whatever he needs. So I say to you, ask, and it will be given to you. Search, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be opened for you. For everyone who asks receives, and everyone who searches finds. And for everyone who knocks, the door will be opened. Is there anyone among you who, if your child asks for a fish, will give a snake instead of a fish? Or if the child asks for an egg, will give a scorpion? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him?" For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us, thanks be to God.
Eternal Spirit of the living.
This morning's sermon is entitled, The Door Will Be Opened. The Door Will Be Opened. Would you pray with me? Gracious and loving God, may the meditations of our hearts and the words that arise to our lips give glory and honor and praise to you in this time and place, as in all times and in all places. Amen.
Yeah.
Is there any way to turn this microphone off? I can use the handheld. I'm not sure if that's what's causing the feedback. Yeah, no problem. I'm glad to preach from wherever.
Yeah, okay.
All right, no problem. We'll try that one. All right, how is this? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Excellent, excellent. Ask, and you shall receive. Seek, and you shall find. Knock, and the door shall be opened to you. I learned these words in Sunday school as a kid, always in the King James Version. And I took them to heart. So much so that by the age of 12, when I knew everything, I assumed that I could pray boldly. And so I did. I prayed to God, it's a true story, for a girlfriend. I was there in bed praying, and I said, God, please, please, God, hallowed be your name. Please, 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 really want a girlfriend. Really, really want a girlfriend. Why did I pray for this? I don't know. I was 12. I knew everything. It all made sense at the time. And so I prayed this way. A few days later, I got a phone call from a girl I'd known since elementary school, who shall remain nameless. And we talked for a while. And to my surprise, she asked if we could go out as boyfriend and girlfriend. And I said, what? You're crazy. No. We've been friends all these years. No. The next day, she called and said, hey, could we be boyfriend and girlfriend? And I said, what? No, I already said no. We're not doing that. The next day, she called back again. And I was so annoyed, I finally said over the phone, look, if I say we're dating, will you stop calling me? She said, yes. I said, great, and hung up the phone. And later that night as I prayed, I realized I needed to be much more careful about what I wished for. And what I prayed for, and how I went about doing it. Prayer is often seen, of course, in some sense, as a fulfillment of wishes, as a place where we take our wants to God, our needs, and more. And it's a time that, you know, we often think of when we think of prayer as, you know, putting our wants before God, our wishes before God. You know, and at best, you know, this is coming from a very good place, a place of wishing that something nice will happen for those that we love. Maybe a friend who is struggling for one reason or another. But, you know, this idea of prayer as wish fulfillment can go haywire, and not just when you're 12 and praying for the wrong thing. For the record, it was another 25 years before I got married. But at worst, this sort of prayer, this view of prayer as wish fulfillment, can kind of devolve into a sort of selfish wishing, the kind of thing that I was doing at that time, for what we want, when we want it, how we want it. And we all know that that's not really how prayer works. We all know that's certainly not how the world works, that we don't just wish for things from our parents or from Santa Claus or from God, and then they automatically happen in exactly the way we thought, exactly how we thought it would happen. We all know that, but yet this vision of prayer can linger in our minds sometimes, this idea of prayer as wish fulfillment. And such a vision of prayer, unfortunately, leads to suffering much of the time. Not always, but much of the time. Sometimes when we pray for something and we don't get what we want, or we don't get it when we want it, or we don't get it how we want it, we get mad. And not just mad at the world, but even mad at God. And this can happen at any age. Whether you're 12, or 42, or 82, any age at all. Sister Joyce Rupp wrote a little bit about this in her book, Dear Heart, Come Home, The Path of Midlife Spirituality. She dedicates a whole chapter in here just to prayer and what it's like and how prayer changes for us as we age. And here in particular, she told a story of a woman at midlife who was a fairly spiritually evolved woman and yet went through the following. Quote, I met a midlife woman who was struggling to find work after her last child left home. As she searched for how best to prepare herself for a future job, she became more and more frustrated at the lack of success she was having. Nothing seemed to fit for her. She began focusing, Rupp continues, on having to have a sign from God that a certain direction would be the right one for her. When this sign didn't come, she felt God had abandoned her and began screaming at God because she felt she'd been let down. Even from the best, most noble spiritual impulses of asking God for a sign and then not getting it can sometimes reveal that we're the ones that wanted the sign in a certain way and in a certain time. Perhaps more dangerous than this, though, is that sometimes when we think of prayer as getting what we want, wishing for something and getting what we want, sometimes we do get what we want. We do get it when we want it, how we want it. And when that happens at times, there's a danger. A danger that we can conclude that our wishes, our will, our way are therefore, by definition, God's wishes, God's will, and God's way. There's danger here. How many wars can each of us imagine throughout history have been fought in the name of God, assuming that what an individual or a political party or a leader or a country or a tribe or a people, what that group wanted was by definition what God wanted, and by any means necessary, they would go out and do what they wanted to do. There are much more intimate and yet equally horrifying forms of violence that have happened as well, when people confuse their desire, their wish, their will, for what God must want. In trying to figure out what exactly prayer is, then, we turn to Jesus in the Gospel of Luke, and we see the disciples trying to figure this out as well. And remember, Luke is writing to Gentile Christians who are coming from a very different religious background and ethnic background. They didn't grow up in Sunday school. They didn't grow up Jewish. They grew up in a completely different religious sphere than the one they're kind of entering here. And so they have a lot of questions. And so they're overhearing the gospel as the disciples ask Jesus to teach them how to pray. And how does Jesus teach them to pray? The answer lies in the very verb to pray. When you read the New Testament in Greek, sometimes it's pretty straightforward. Christos is Christ. That seems pretty straightforward. Petros is Peter. You can kind of follow along even if you don't read Greek. Other times, if you read a little bit, you can see, well, this word means that, and you know, it's fairly straightforward. But sometimes you run into these complex words where the Greeks are taking one word and smushing it together with another word to make something that's more than either of those words separately. And that's what our author is doing with the verb to pray in this passage. Luke has some of the most elegant Greek in the entire New Testament, along with the book of Acts, which originally were two volumes of the same text. The word in Greek for to pray in this morning's passage is proseukomai, or proseukomemnon, depending on which version of the verb you're putting together. It's a complex word, and it's made up of other words. Pros, the first part, is moving towards someone to exchange something with a person. Eukomai is to wish, to desire in that sense, to wish for something. So proseukomai means, in a very real sense, to exchange wishes. To exchange wishes. Said another way, to pray, according to the Gospel of Luke and according to Jesus teaching the disciples, to pray is to exchange one's own wishes for the wishes of God. Right there in the very verb itself, to exchange one's own wishes for the wishes of God. So when Jesus teaches the disciples to pray, again, this verb is used over and over to make sure the reader is catching it. To me, even though I grew up in church hearing the Lord's Prayer all the time, I began to read the Lord's Prayer a little differently today. Where I usually say, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done." Suddenly, in this context, the Lord's Prayer reads more like, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven, where you are, O God." Suddenly, the Lord's Prayer is about a means of helping the disciples to exchange their will for God's will, to exchange their wishes for God's wishes, to align, to figure out that there's maybe a gap sometimes between what we want and what God wants. And over time, by praying this prayer over and over again, by saying these words, to more fully align those two things, so that our will and God's will become more aligned over time, so that it's God's will moving through us, God's wishes moving through us, God's desires moving through us out into the world. In trying to describe this phenomenon in a more modern sense, Rupp concludes her story about this woman at midlife I mentioned earlier. There was a turning point for her, you see. And she writes, quote, "The turning point for this woman came for her when she began to see God, not as a magical answer person pointing the way, but rather as a compassionate presence, urging her to trust her talents and her life experiences. This changing image of God influenced her greatly as she grew more peaceful inside, approaching her job hunt with greater confidence." End quote. Saying our prayers at night before bed when we're children is a wonderful thing. And it's a wonderful thing to keep doing throughout life. Praying together in worship, as we have this morning through the Lord's Prayer and more, is a wonderful thing to do. Wonderful thing to do each Sunday. And if we're being honest, the experience of prayer as a person of faith changes over time. Times when we feel closer to God, further from God, times when the old forms of prayer that we used somehow aren't working anymore, aren't working the way we would like. If you're experiencing that this morning, you are not alone. I would just say to you, remember, prayer is not about a specific form. It's not about a specific thing you have to do in a certain particular way, in a certain prescribed ritual. It's about the finding ways to reorient yourself, to remember, to focus on God's will, to pray that God's kingdom might come, that God's will might be done, that the earth might reflect God's heavenly principles and desires. And so the practice of prayer, whether that's a walking meditation in the woods, whether that's a silent retreat, whether that's praying together with friends after Bible study, whether that's praying alone at home, whatever form your prayer may be taking, and it can take many legitimate, wonderful forms. At heart, it is about that big picture of aligning our will with God's will and allowing life to flow from there. Our God is indeed a gift-giving God, as I told the children earlier. And when we hear the things that the people in the scripture ask for, they're not asking for themselves, if you noticed. When the friend comes knocking on his friend's door late at night, it's in order to do the godly thing, to be a good host, to welcome the stranger or welcome the friend into his home. When the parent is asking for something, when the child is asking for something and the parent's offering it, it's coming from a loving place of genuinely wanting to help and feed the child. When we come from this place of aligning ourselves more and more fully with God's will over time, then when we ask, we really do receive. Part of the reason I wanted to hear Eternal Spirit of the Living Christ this morning is because of verse 2. And in case you didn't catch it, I just want to read this again really briefly because I think it encapsulates so much of this spirit. Don't worry about your bulletins. You can look at them later. I'll read it for you now. Unless you like to read along, that's fine too. But the second verse of Eternal Spirit of the Living Christ reads as follows. Come, pray in me the prayer I need this day. Help me to see your purpose and your will. Where I have failed, what I have done amiss, held in forgiving love, let me be still. I love that. Come pray in me the prayer I need this day. The hymn writer saying, your will and your way, God. When we really do come from such a place, no matter how we pray, no matter what form our prayer takes, when we understand prayer not to be asking a genie to fulfill our every wish, but aligning ourselves with God's will and allowing God's will to become our will and to flow through us, then, because of that, we are therefore able to ask for God's will to be done, and we really do receive. We're able to seek the kingdom of God, and we really do find. Because of God's love for us, because of the gifts that God gives, we really are able to knock on God's heavenly door. And the door will be opened. Amen.
Every Sunday, this church is here, gathered to worship and observe Sabbath. But church is more than what we do within these walls. It is calling to the greater mission to meet people where they are and to embrace the new thing that God calls each of us into. Whatever that call may be for you and for this church, we thank you for all the ways that you support this church in time, talent, and money. Please feel free to give digitally through our website or by leaving a retiring offering in the offering plates as you exit after the service. Also, if you are in a place of urgent need due to the coronavirus, please contact a member of staff to make use of the Deacon's Relief Fund, which we have set aside. Thank you all for your gifts and your giving.
Master, thou callest, I gladly obey. Only direct me, and I'll find thy way. Teach me the mission appointed for me. What is my labor and where it shall be? Master, thou callest, and this I reply, ready and willing, Lord, here am I. Willing, my Savior, to take up the cross, willing to suffer reproaches and a loss, willing to follow if thou wilt but lead. Only support me with grace in my need. Master, thou callest, and this I reply, ready and willing, Lord, here am I. Living or dying, I still would be thine. Yet I am mortal, while thou art divine. Pardon wherever I turn from the right. Pity and bring me again to the light. Master, thou callest, and this I reply, ready and willing, Lord, here am I, here am I.
Yeah.
Friends, we share our prayers of hope and concern, confident that God listens to our prayers and calls us together in response. We invite you to share these prayers now by raising a hand in the sanctuary and sharing them after being called, or by commenting on the YouTube page. After each prayer, we say, God in your mercy or grace, hear our prayer.
This is a prayer, I suppose, of joy. I understand that the Pope is going to Canada to offer apologies to all the Native Americans who were put in schools where their nativeness was eliminated, where they lost their history, their language, their culture. And it went on from the early 1800s to 1990. I pray that the Pope will be successful in having people listen and that they will try to forgive. Thank you.
And God in our grace.
A prayer of good wishes for my friend Anne, who's just leaving on a 10-hour car trip. And she's 80, so it's a trip for her, a lot of hours. So thank you.
And God in our grace.
I pray that the world will see that the global warming is here in full force right now all over the world, what is happening. I was actually in Texas last week, and it was 111 for 3 days, almost 4 days in a row. Also, it was 97 where it was much cooler when I had to go to Nebraska and then come back to Texas, and it was still 111. It is completely brown as these pews, and people are having to sell their cattle. They cannot feed them. This is dire straits now, and I think it has warped speed that faster than we ever thought it would. I just pray that people wake up to this.
God in our mercy.
I have a couple of prayers. I just found out this morning that one of Rainer's coworkers, Emily, she and her husband lost their baby daughter last night. So I can't imagine what they're going through. It's, an unimaginable loss for a parent to lose a child, but especially that young. And then the second prayer that I have is for my daughter, who is still having difficulties with my son-in-law. He's threatening to cut off her car insurance now. So he's basically not giving her anything and saying that my ex and I can supply all of her needs, and he's done. So I hope that will somehow that will get resolved, and she'll move forward with the divorce.
God in our mercy.
I'd like prayers for Reverend Love. I don't know what's going on, but there's something going on, and she needs our prayers.
God in our mercy.
I have a prayer of gratitude and joy. My friend Marcy, who has pancreatic cancer, has been getting special kinds of treatments in the last month, and they seem to have helped her to regain some strength, and she feels much, much better. As a matter of fact, they're able to go on vacation to their place up at the St. Lawrence River next week, and she's going to be driving up there. It's an 8-hour drive, and I am just so grateful, and this is my prayer of gratitude for Marcy's at least temporary reprieve from pancreatic cancer.
And God in our grace.
Yeah, grace.
friends, we now pause in silence to hold those prayers which we have not given voice to today. God, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayer. Let us now conclude our prayer with the prayer for peace, saying, O loving God, Spirit of hope and peace, lead us from death to life. Lead us from falsehood to truth. Lead us from despair to hope, from fear to trust. Lead us from hate to love, from war to peace. Let peace fill our hearts, our world, our universe. Peace.
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 For our final hymn, we are going to sing verses 1, 2, and 4. Thank you.
So welcoming and gracious to me, and it is a delight to be with you this morning and always. In that spirit of joy and gratitude for you and for all that God does in and through you, please receive this blessing. Go forth this day, friends, being you with God's love and will flowing through you. For God's will is indeed love. Love for all of creation, for our neighbors, and yes, for ourselves. May God's love and will flow through you, blessing the world, everywhere that you go. Know that when you ask, you shall receive. That when you seek, you will find. And when you knock, the door will be opened for you, with God's loving arms awaiting you. Amen.
Amen.